So young people, this morning as we gather, you've heard a lot of us talk about this, that, and with the election coming up, but here's the thing. Going to the polls this week is making a choice. But can I share with you that I believe it's a safe statement that every person who has been on this stage and shared something in one shape or another this morning about what's coming up on Tuesday would agree that the most important choice is not made in a ballot box in the United States of America, but it's the choice of whether or not you're going to choose to follow God or not follow God. It's that simple. And so can I encourage you that voting and everything else is important, but the most important thing, because it's eternal, is the choice that you have to make to believe in God and accept what he's done for you through his son Jesus, or to say, I'm going to do it my way and not believe in God. I encourage you, make the choice to trust God and be on his team. That's the most important thing I can share with you. And that's what I want to share with you this morning. So pray with me. Father, I pray that each and every one of these young men and women, if they have praised you, made the decision for you, praise you for that. If they haven't, I pray they will. Father, I just pray that your love, your mercy, your grace, that they will see that, your power, and that without you, there's not much hope. That they will choose to follow you, choose to accept the gift of your son and the lordship of his life in us. God, I just pray your protection on them today and every day. In your name we pray, amen. You are dismissed for kids church, for youth for Christ, what? Kids for Christ, K4C, yeah, for Christ, there we go. Yeah.
Whatever we call it.
Whatever we call it. So anyway, okay. While they're going, I'm going to move a little bit here.
Which stool do you want?
I want that one. That's mine.
Okay, all right. I thought they were both yours.
Well, this one I haven't ever got to sit on yet. So I told Jacob, we were, Debbie and I were up in Sun Valley, Ketchum, and we were at that thrift store, the gold mine, and I found this stool for $5, and I'm like, that's just way too cool. I've got to purchase that. And then I just haven't used it. It's been sitting here and it'd been back in the classroom, and so I'm like, I'm going to use it, even though I thought about using that taller one over there. Actually, this one's not mine. That one is mine, the taller one. But oh. I thought having him on a shorter one, that doesn't. Anyway, well, good morning. We're going to do something a little bit different today. And we've been thinking and praying about this for several months. One of the things that I enjoy working together with Jacob is two or three times a week, early in the day, we'll sit down in my office and just talk. We'll catch up on each other's weeks. We'll catch up on how things are going with our church family that we've been praying for and loving on and working together with and ministering to. And we'll talk theory, we'll talk philosophy, we'll talk concerns, we'll talk politics, and we'll talk about, well, where are we going with our sermons in the next while? Because if you guys are pretty quick and clever, and you've noticed that we've been working together more and more on that, and Jacob has been very influential on what series we do and when we do, and since he's getting to preach part of them. This year, 2024, part of it has been very intentional, part of it's been just God directing and leading, but I feel like the whole year has been preparing us for this week. You know, we spent the first 4 months of the year going through the book of 1 Peter, a time when the church was persecuted. The church was being misrepresented. They were being treated horribly. And it was a good lesson for us of how do Christians live and behave when those type of things are going on. Not that we have faced it fully in our country, but there's been a lot different than it used to be, and I would think everybody would agree we're not a Christian nation anymore. I've heard a lot of the terms post-Christian, and because culture has passed us. The principles that made this country great definitely were founded upon the morality of God, the Old Testament and New Testament, definitely. But the influence of that has gone away compared to what it used to be. None of us can argue that. But then we spent some time this summer going through the book of Acts, where we saw churches that were dealing with persecution. We saw preachers and teachers that were dealing with persecution and opposition, even Paul being stoned, left for dead. And it's kind of like, okay, that hasn't happened here, but it's happening in other parts of the world on a daily basis. So as Christians, how do we respond when that happened? We were intentional with our fall series on the one true God. That was intentional of reminding us who it is that we serve, who it is that we have given our lives to. And the month of November is very intentional. We're looking at the living word. We're looking at elements of the word of God that is eternal, both from the Old Testament and the New Testament. Things are eternal. So we got to thinking about, well, what do we kick that series off in the month of November with? And Jacob's like, Psalm 2. I got my Bible out. I read it. And I'm like, you're right. But we want to, before we start that, there's something that we want to do that is definitely different. And we want to share with you two perspectives, experiences of what a presidential election is. And I get to start because I'm the old guy. I don't remember much about elections in our country till I was 8 years old, which was 1969 when Richard Nixon was elected president. That's what I remember. And then a few years later, he resigned. And then there was a steady stream of elections that I watched happen. And then the next most significant to me was in 1980, because I was 18 years old and I got to cast my vote for president of the United States for the first time. And that was a big deal. That was a big deal. I took that incredibly, incredibly seriously. I did my homework, and I dug and tried to figure out and find out as much as I could about both candidates. But here's the thing that I remember. Elections in those days were, campaigns in those days were much more civilized. There were ads, of course, there were debates, but it was different. There weren't constant interruptions by the opposing candidate when somebody was trying to talk. There were no fact checkers that were sitting there interrupting the speakers as they went, making it more about them than about the candidates. And there was civility between the candidates. There was discussion about the pros and cons of each candidate, their platform, their policy. There were a lot of live press conferences where reporters could ask them questions, and you got the feel for a person and what kind of leadership by how they could think on the spot. Because if they answered in a poor fashion, it was going to make them look really, really silly. There were no teleprompters when they were speaking. There were no scripted interviews. There was no constant barrage of propaganda coming out by people with more money than sense that are trying to convince you of something that they want you to be convinced of. After the votes were cast and counted, the losing candidate would call the winning candidate, congratulate them, and thank them for their campaign, and wish them well as they put their government together. Then everybody got to work, and the rest of us went back to work. But things started to change, and there was a viciousness in the attacks on a character's candidacy, their character and their abilities. It was brutal. More so in the primaries, when it was Democrats against Democrats and Republicans against Republicans. I'm kind of like at the end of the campaign, after they've selected their candidate, I'm like, well, how can you even support this person with the things you said about them during the campaign of the primary that you were trying to get elected. It was just absolutely crazy. But much has changed over the years, and it pales, and my experience pales in comparison to a lot of you. So to the young people and to Jacob, I want to say you shouldn't be surprised when people say, oh, I wish it could go back the way it used to be. Because what we see now wasn't what it used to be. It wasn't like that. And in fact, it doesn't even resemble what it is now. And it is scary. And yet that's everybody's, what they're dealing with today. And it's not everybody's experience. And so we thought it'd be cool for me to share what I remember and to have Jacob share what he's witnessed and seen in his lifestyle. So go ahead.
Yeah. So I was thinking back of the first election I remember. It's not the Nixon one, believe it or not.
I am not a crook. Sorry.
For me, honestly, the one I actually remember hearing people talk about was when Obama was elected. So, yes, I'm young. But my experience every election year is that there is always a spirit of anger and fear. Respect, I've never actually heard a candidate respected that wasn't the person that people were voting for. So that contrasting of Republican versus Democrat, it's only gotten stronger. I think social media, I think the rise of technology has just made it worse. I mean, the ability to bash the opposing party without really the consequences of speaking in public or speaking face to face has given people a lot more boldness to say things they would never say face to face. We live in such a culture that honestly, the ability to hide behind a screen has given us permission to be a lot more disrespectful. And I remember, and I think this really speaks to one, why I'm doing what I'm doing here, as well as I think it should be a challenge to our parents, is that you have kids listening. I've made this joke, but it is true. I know that your kids are listening because they tell me how I should vote. It's true. And I hear them repeating exactly what I'm sure you would tell me. And it's something that the fear and the anger that I heard and honestly inherited was something that I heard from my folks. I grew up in a very conservative and homeschooled home. And I remember the fear that came with Obama coming. I remember hearing people even say that he was the Antichrist, getting up to that point. And really living with this fear of not only are we having someone who doesn't have our best in mind, but it could be the enemy. And just hearing all of these things that influenced my young life. And I had a lot more fear that I carried on my shoulders as an 8 to 10-year-old. That more than I ever should at that point. And so I just think it's really important. One, that contrast of when I hear people say things should go back to the way they used to be, I have no concept. Well, when I hear that prayer was not only allowed for teachers to start off their class with prayer, no concept for that. All of my friends, all the people I grew up around who went to public school, that was not something they dealt with. So I have no the way it used to be. This is all I've ever experienced. And I think that's important for us as intergenerational believers to understand. Is that we can't have older believers looking at younger believers who have no concept of what you experience as the way it used to be, and looking at them and getting frustrated because they need people to come alongside and disciple them. But also, I think our young believers need to understand that they're also setting an example for what it looks like to be a believer in these new times that we're experiencing. And so I think as we kind of dive into this, we need to acknowledge that there is a learning on both ends. That younger believers should be able to look to believers that have gone before them and learn, well, this is how we managed to fight against injustice in this way. This is how we stood up for what was right in this way. And also be able to defer to young believers when it's like, well, that's not something we can even stand for anymore. That's not something that we even have a concept for, what is right and what is wrong and what can be done in school. There are still great ways that students can stand for their faith in school, but because of how things have changed, they have to be more wise about it. And honestly, there are a lot of students who don't even know what's permissible for them to do in their schools. And so just this, again, like intergenerational Christians need to encourage and challenge each other in this. And I think, again, as we get ready to look at what this text says, parents, if I can encourage you with anything, don't make the most important thing you pass on to your kids is that every 4 years you need to be anxious, you need to be ready to be angry at the other party, but instead, remember where your hope is found.
You know, I made the comment months ago when acknowledging the election's coming up, we need to be praying about it more than we're talking about it. And I had several conversations with people the last couple of weeks as we were back in Ohio with people that they, especially in the airport, on the airplanes, they want to engage in politics. And I'm very wise and careful with how I respond, and I don't back down, and I share my thoughts and my feelings. But a lot of times it's by asking questions rather than making statements. And that's one of the things I share with them, is that I have been trying to remind myself to pray more than I talk. And definitely there's a place for both. But if I truly trust that God's got this, then I'm going to trust him in the process. So we want to look at Psalms 2. So if you've got your Bible, turn there with us. And we're going to kind of talk through this together. The second psalm was written by a man that filled a number of roles over the course of his life. He was a son, he was a shepherd, he was a singer, songwriter. At times he was a hunter, at other times he was the hunted. He was a soldier, he was a friend, he was a husband, he was a murderer, he was a father, and he was a king. And of course, David is who wrote Psalm 2. We know that because in the book of Acts, he's given credit for it. And in other passages of the New Testament, including the book of Revelation, references the second psalm and as a messianic psalm. And it's interesting, as we've been spending time looking at this, talking about this, the time when David wrote these words has an uncanny resemblance to life as we know it in 2024. So let's take a look. We're going to start of the first look at how the world is, okay? And first three verses. Why are the nations so angry? Why do they waste their time with futile plans? There's a lot there. And can I just share with you that apart from God, your plans are going to be not nearly as successful as they can be when they're with God. And that's the question David asks. Why are the nations so angry? Why do they waste their time with futile plans? He acknowledges, apart from God, there's nothing that works. The kings of the earth prepare for battle. The rulers plot together against the Lord and against his anointed one. Messianic psalm. It's not only what's going on here, but also in the future. The anointed one, the king of Israel, certainly has God established it, but secondly, the eternal king, Jesus. Verse 3, let us break their chains, they cry, and free ourselves from slavery to God. What a laugh. There's a couple things there. I mean, apart from God, confusion, chaos, anger, so much more. David can write these words because he had a front row seat to seeing nations and kings coming against God and the children of God. Early in David's life, serving his dad, and he was sent to the battlefront to take some food to his brothers who were with the nation of the armies of Israel trying to defeat the Philistines. Basically trying to beat a Philistine by the name of Goliath, a giant of a man. And David saw that firsthand, as well as when he was actually the king of Israel. He got to see how to go against the nations that would try to overcome Israel. Fast forward 300 years from when David wrote these words. We talked about a month ago about King Hezekiah in 2 Kings 19. And we learned about the king of Assyria sending him a letter saying basically, give up now. You cannot win. I have more power than the children of God and the nation of Israel. Nobody can defeat me. And so we're going to come on. We're going to destroy the children of God. We're going to take Jerusalem. And that's basically the king's threat. And Hezekiah knew on a physical basis, Sennacherib and his armies could do that, exactly that. They could lay all of the nations surrounding them to waste. But his mindset was, God isn't big enough to stop me. And he's not the first that had that mindset. And he certainly wouldn't be the last. Going to the Rome, you see evidence and things about the emperor of Rome. And the emperor of Rome didn't claim he could defeat God. He claimed he was God. There are some of the ruins in some of the ancient cities of the Roman Empire that the inscriptions are, the emperor is God. And that's nothing new. That's nothing new. They thought they were breaking the chains that they had, that God had put them in, and then they would be free. But the problem of it is, sometimes the chains are there for your good, to protect you, to keep you safe. They didn't understand that breaking forth from this isn't going to bring you freedom. It's going to cause you great harm. Let's put it this way. You can take a fish out of water, but does that make that fish free? No, it makes it dinner. Or take a tree. You can remove a tree and you can pull the roots completely out of the ground. Does that make that tree free? No. Without proper nutrition and connection to the nutrients it needs, it's going to die. And that's the relationship God has for all of us. It's not that he's given us these rules and ways to live to bind us and to enslave us. It's to protect us and provide for us. It's true of nations that choose to ignore God. They're going to die without him. And it's true of people who try to do the same.
Sorry, I turn off my mic because I'm coughing today. It's a good time. And not only is that true with the other nations around, but believe it or not, Christians and even God's people in the Old Testament also had this view of God's ways being a little bit different than what I want. I mean, look at the beginning, right? God gives them all of the garden to enjoy. You can enjoy any fruit on any of these trees except for that one. And the temptation the enemy really pulls at is, did God really say that you shouldn't do this? Right? And actually, he doesn't say, like, well, just rebel. That's a ridiculous rule. But instead, he gets them to question God's intention for their people, for his people. He says this, God doesn't want you to do that because then you'll realize you can become just like God. And eventually, Eve gives in. So does Adam. And they realize the error of their ways. And yet God is still gracious. But then you fast forward and God saves his people from slavery. Right? And yet God's way is a way that's different than ours, because they've been in slavery for 400 years. And then God goes to Moses and he says, I have heard the cries of my people. And yet God's timing is 400 years. So we need to acknowledge one thing, that God's way is different than how I would do it. And with that, God's way is better than how I would do it, even if I don't understand why at the moment. Because God saves his people from Egypt and he brings them to the wilderness. And he provides manna, this mysterious substance. I just got done reading through Numbers, and there's a point where they're like, we are sick of eating the manna God has provided us. And they had this mindset, it was better for us in Egypt. They had this mindset of, basically, we had 3 square meals a day, and like almost treating it like Egypt was some sort of resort. And yet they were imprisoned, they were suffering, they were dying. But they forgot, because God's way makes us uncomfortable. God's way is different than how I would do it. And God's way is different than the ways of this world. And so within believers, within God's own people, there's this temptation to do away with God's way because I want my way. eventually when they go into the promised land and the prophet Samuel is there, they talk to Samuel and they go, we want a king just like all the other nations. What's funny is Samuel gets kind of offended because he was kind of the representative for God, and he goes and he's like, can you believe what your people are saying here? And God goes, why are you offended? They're not rejecting you, they're rejecting me. And God even warns them. He says, you know, if you have a king just like everyone else, those kings are going to act just like everyone else. If you put your hope, if you put your identity in a human leader, they will fail you just like any other human leader will. He says, they will enslave your family members. They will tax you. They will do all of these things. And they go, yeah, give us a king. So, Christians and the people of God, they are not exempt from this foolish heart to say, let us do away with God's way. In my own heart, I have to wrestle with this mindset of, I know better. Just because God's way is a little uncomfortable. And so as we continue looking at this, we need to acknowledge we're not just saying those foolish people. But we're admitting there's a bit of a fool in all of us that we have to submit to this king.
Absolutely.
So shall we continue in the text here? Starting in verse 4, I'll go ahead and read this one. But the one who rules in heaven laughs. The Lord scoffs at them. Then in anger he rebukes them, terrifying them with his fierce fury. Because I'm such a Bible scholar, the picture that comes to mind with this comes from Indiana Jones. I don't know, I can't remember which movie, but there's the scene where he's running and he ends up, there's this huge guy that pulls out a big sword and he's swinging it around, right? And he's really threatening. What? There we go. All right, so if you want to watch it later, ask Scott and everyone else who said it and you can do that. But right after he does this like really intimidating sword play, Indiana Jones pulls out a gun and shoots him. And it's like, from one perspective, it's like, oh no, what are we going to do? But in a battle between a sword and a gun, my money's on the gun. And it's the same thing where it's like the nations around us, the nation can rage against and it can look like an unwinnable battle. But I just love this phrase here, the one who rules in heaven laughs. Like, I don't know, that's intimidating and comforting at the same time. Like, I don't know, if I lived in a way that made God laugh, I hope it was in a good way.
It reminds me of like when my grandsons were probably 7 or 8, I can take you, old man, and I'm like, yeah, right. You know, I had to show him. I had to sit on him for 30 minutes, completely unable to move, before he'd admit Grandpa is better. Then as soon as I let him go, bring it on, old man, bring it on. It's like, that's what God's like. I love this kid, but are they ever going to learn? I don't know.
Did someone say no? Sorry, that was funny. But what came to my mind with this is, one, it's simply this, and I think this is where our hope needs to be found. God is not hindered or afraid by earthly opposition in the slightest. It's been said already, God's not like biting his nails, waiting for Tuesday to come and go. And no matter who it is that ends up in the position, God will probably laugh either way because his will be accomplished. And I think as people who claim that is...
Make sure you clarify that. He's not going to laugh at you. It's like,
no.
But he knows that laughter is an understanding and a recognition that my ways will be done.
Yeah. So when I was really young, our neighbors had this little chihuahua. And I was terrified of it as a kid. And so we'd go out and get the mail, and this chihuahua would chase us. I was probably 8. I was way bigger than this chihuahua was, but my mom, we have these big windows in our out looking at our front yard, and she sees her youngest child at the time running in tears from a dog that's about this big. And she comes out, she's like, why don't you kick it? I'm like, that thing's going to bite me here and go all the way up. Are you kidding me? And I had this mindset, but that's kind of the picture. Is like what seems threatening to us, what seems like something that could be world ending, God's looking down and he's like, it's no problem at all. That's the laughter. It's not you fools, that's not even something I'm worried about. And I think as people who claim our hope is in God more than whoever is in charge, we need to go back and lean on that.
Absolutely.
The second thing that kind of came to my mind, sorry, I had a note there. It's this. It talks about God's anger and God's judgment. And if that makes us uncomfortable, it's there and it should. We were never meant to like the texts that talk about God's judgment and God's anger. I had this conversation with a friend this week where it's like, I don't like the conquest texts in the book of Joshua or whatever it is because they're intense and they're harsh. And when we see texts talking about God's judgment or God's wrath, like, that's not the daily devotional that just I walk away feeling comforted by that.
The book of Judges, you need to go there. That's a little easier to deal with.
Yeah, the book of Judges, right? No one's going like, right? Because God's judgment isn't something we're supposed to enjoy. It's something that we're supposed to live in light of. And actually, Andy shared this example that I really appreciated. And so it says this, after God laughs, he judges. Is he justified in this? Absolutely. If someone broke into my house, grabbed my wife, and threatened to torture her, I would say, stop. If you need to torture someone, torture me. But if after I absorbed the beating, she ran off with him, my anger would be understandable. The Lord came to the earth to die for the sins of the whole world. He paid the price willingly and died in our place sacrificially. Is his wrath justified when he sees his people chasing after the very one he came to rescue them from? Unquestionably.
And that's something we don't often talk about. But it's kind of like sin. When God looks at us and what he's done for us and when he sees us saying, I don't care what you did, I'm going to do what I want to do, of course he gets frustrated and disappointed. It's like a parent telling our child, don't do this because it's going to be consequences, and they do it anyway. You better let them deal with the consequences, or they're never going to stop or learn. So it's challenging, but yeah. Well, a loving God would never punish or, sorry. It's just confusing and it's hard. It really is. So anyway, but then he continues on in verse 6. For the Lord declares, I've placed my chosen king on the throne in Jerusalem, on my holy mountain. The king proclaims the Lord's decree. The Lord said to me, you're my son. Today, I've become your father. There is a lot of things that David did, but one thing we didn't mention is he's also a prophet. Because here in verse 7 and 6, he's talking about putting a king. I mean, he selected Saul, then David, and then Solomon, and then it kind of got muddy from there on. But God put the king for them, but the kings pretty much all forgot God's in charge, not them. But David's also referring to the coming king. Nobody's going to forget him. We still celebrate and worship him 2,000 years after he went back to be with his father at his right hand side. I just think that's so important to recognize that.
Yeah. And as he continues, he makes this statement, only ask and I will give you the nations as your inheritance, the whole earth as your possession. You will break them with an iron rod and smash them like clay pots. Again, like, this is judgment language, and like what Andy's been saying, as there is an immediate context, ultimately this points to Jesus, that Jesus is God's anointed one who will eventually come back and restore all things and also bring the final judgment. And so there's not really like a lot to be read into this. It's simply saying that Jesus is the one who will be established to judge on these nations that are rebelling, but also between the wicked and the righteous, those that who have put their faith in Christ and those who haven't. And so again, it's not which candidate is your hope in, it's your trust in the anointed one of God. That's kind of what we're looking at here.
That phrase, the broken pots. I mean, we talked a few weeks ago about the potter can take something that's cracked or marred or flawed and reshape it, rework it, use it for something different, and still have purpose and value. But man, when you take a clay pot and you just smash it to smithereens, like we see in that illustration, there's not much coming back from that. And yet I've seen pieces of artwork, and in fact, all throughout the Middle East, through Turkey, through Greece, through Italy, in the footsteps of Paul, all throughout Israel, there are mosaics that are made with fragments of clay and glass that had been shattered and thrown away as useless, and somebody has the eye that they can take that and put it back together. I think that's the promise of what the coming king was going to do. He can take and remake something beautiful, repurposed again, even if it seems it's gone and it's absolutely nothing can be done. God is the master creator, the master designer, and there is always hope as long as we keep our eyes on him. His will is going to be done, and his judgment is going to be final, and that's important for us to remember. Then we come to the last couple verses, and we want to do something here a little bit different. We want you to be a part of this. We're going to share a portion of the text, but then it's going to come up, and we want you to share what the final promise of Psalm 2 is to the children of God. So we didn't practice this, so bear with us, okay?
I'm regretting not practicing this at this point.
I know, it's okay.
It's a good time.
All right, now then, you kings, act wisely. Be warned, you rulers of the earth. Serve the Lord with reverent fear and rejoice with trembling. Submit to God's royal Son, or he will become angry, and you will be destroyed in the midst of all your activities, for his anger flares up in an instant. But you get to share the promise. Congregation, share with this. Let's try that one more time, because I know you can do better than that, okay? This is a promise, y'all. This is something that's worth celebrating. This was worth coming to town today for. But what joy for all who take refuge in him. The reality is the world has always tried to set itself up. The kings of the world, the people of the world. I mean, Adam and Eve, people have said, God, I know better. We've always tried to set ourselves up against his authority. But every one of us is going to be held accountable to the king in the end. And that is true not just for us, and not just for kings and for nations, but it's true for individuals as well. I was sharing with Jacob when we went to church last Sunday with our kids in Ohio. We got to go to church, and they were talking about unbreakable faith. And they talked about Daniel. They told the story of Daniel, and it was a powerful message. Daniel had been taken captive and was in Babylon, and his leadership and his wisdom had stood out. And so he had been elevated to a position of great authority in King Darius's kingdom. And it was to the point that people could see, especially the other elevated leaders of the government under the king, that Daniel was kind of the first right-hand guy. He was getting all the... So they're like, his power is greater than ours. We've got to do something. So they set up, came up with a way. They watched him to try to find something they could accuse him of. There was nothing. He was doing it right. So finally they came to the conclusion, the only thing we can catch him in is his faith, because it's against the king. I mean, Darius and the kingdom was not the children of God and the kingdom of God. And so they got they basically talked the king into setting this rule, this law, that for 30 days nobody could do anything or worship anybody or anything but the king. And if they were caught doing it, going against that, they were thrown into the lion's den, which obviously that's not going to go well for anybody. But I chuckled. The thing that caught my attention is, what did Daniel do when he found out that the king had made that decree, a decree that he couldn't take back? For 30 days, this was the law. What did Daniel do in the face of the king's decree? In Daniel 6:10, we see what he did. When he learned that the decree had been published, he went home to his upstairs room where the windows opened toward Jerusalem. Three times a day he got down on his knees and prayed, giving thanks to his God, just as he had always done. That's the thing. What did Daniel do when he found out they tricked the king? There's this law, if I continue to worship God the way I always have, I'm going to be executed. Because that's really what being thrown in the lion's den was. It's an execution. Daniel had the kind of faith that would bend, but it didn't break. That's a lot of times in sports, you'll have a team that has a defense strategy. We're going to bend, we're going to give a little bit here and there, but we're not going to break. And that's kind of what Daniel did. And I think that that's what we need to understand. We live in a world that is absolutely crazy in some ways. Some of the things that people say is right, we're like, it's black and white. No, it's not. But they don't care. Truth is irrelevant. Even when it comes to the media, how they report and everything else, it doesn't matter. You can't believe anything hardly anybody says. But what we can believe is the Word of God. And that he is still on his throne. And none of the silliness that we see going on in America right now, but it's gone on all throughout the world at other times, is changing the fact that God is still is on his throne and that Jesus is still the King of King eternal. And so I pray that we would do like Daniel, like Joseph, like David most of the time, except for when he was having brain fades and forgetting to be a man after God's own heart, and that we will continue to do what we know is right in the eyes of God. And that we will bend but not break, no matter what happens. That's what we need to recognize. When we entrust ourselves to the eternal King, we can handle whatever the world throws our way. We might not like it. We might not like it. There might be things that because of morality in our faith that we have to, like the early Christians, say, I can't do this, I won't, and if it means you're going to take my life, like Daniel, you're going to throw me in a lion's den, then so be it. I will not go against what my God has said and what he has said. You see, we can't control the actions of rulers and authorities, but we can pray for them. We can't control the outcome of elections, but we can control our reactions to them. We can't control the events of this world, but we can control where we put our hope for eternity. Our hope and our trust as followers of Jesus, as followers of God, children of God, is the only thing that's going to be eternal, the only thing that's going to last. And so may we put our hope in God. God's got this. I'm not going to be afraid because I know he's with me. Like Joshua going in to take the land that God had promised, we're going to be strong and courageous. We're going to choose this day to serve the living one true God. Yeah. You had an application for
it. Yeah. Well, I think with Daniel and with a lot of these texts, it really reveals the truth that what you run to for hope shows what you worship. And so for Daniel, when this threat happened, he's like, I'm still going to pray because that is where my source of hope is. In the book of Acts, chapter 4, I'm not going to read the text to you, but basically Peter and John are preaching. They heal someone. They're brought before the religious leaders, and basically they tell them, it's because of Jesus that this man was healed. It's because of Jesus that we're preaching what we're preaching. And the religious leaders are like, these guys are making us look really bad. And they come together and they're like, we can't really, they haven't done anything wrong. We can't beat someone up for making someone's life better. That's just terrible policy. But they basically come back and they're like, don't preach in the name of this guy Jesus again, or you will face serious consequences. And they come back to the fellowship, to the church in Jerusalem, and they're excited. They're like, guys, guess what? We got threatened. Isn't that awesome? And they begin to pray, and they pray, Sovereign Lord, your servant David prayed, and they quote, why do the nations rage and the peoples plot in vain? They quote Psalm 2. And then they continue, and they say, Lord, in light of this, that there is opposition trying to stop your church, they don't say, destroy them. They don't say, Let us be able to tell them how wrong they are so that they say, give us boldness to live out the gospel in spite of this opposition. They don't ask for the opposition to stop. They don't ask for the opposition to be done away with. They ask for the ability to boldly live out their faith and preach the gospel in spite of it. And I think that's true when Paul says that we are citizens of heaven, right? No matter where we're at, no matter what country we live in, our ultimate allegiance is to the eternal King first. And that means I will obey and I will be a good citizen where I'm at, but ultimately I will live as a citizen of heaven, even if it means I stand out whatever nation, whatever place I live at, because that is where my allegiance is to first. That I will live differently because I am from a different place. My home is not America first, it is heaven. My king, my leader is not whoever's president, it is God. And that means I will stand out, I will live differently, but also I will live to a higher standard that God calls me to. Not to just tell those who oppose the church that they're wrong, but instead to live this countercultural way that Jesus lived. Forgive those and pray for those who persecute you. Love those that are difficult to love. That is the way of the eternal King.
So here's the deal. We want to close our time together this morning by praying with you. And so we'd ask you to join with us. I want you to hear this. I am incredibly grateful to live where I live, to be a citizen of the United States. And I believe that, I mean, I've been all over the world, and I'm grateful for the foundations and for the moral truths that established this country and gave us the freedoms and the rights and the responsibilities that we have enjoyed as citizens of this country. Nothing we've said today in any way, shape, or form is to disparage or to put down or to deny the incredible gift it is and has been to be a citizen of the United States. It's just to recognize that America has been blessed in so many ways because people were first and foremost kingdom citizens. I don't think we can argue that. So as we go to the vote, as we go to the polls, we go to the ballot, we go to cast our ballots this week, or if we already have, that's fine, but let's pray. And so we just want to, we're going to just kind of work our way through a few things that we think would be good to pray. And we're going to lead the prayer this morning. But just let's bow together and spend some time as a church family praying for things that are going to significantly impact a lot of what we know and how we are. Because every election has that ability and possibility. So let's pray to start with by praising the eternal King. Father, I'm so grateful that it is so clear of who you are. Even as the scripture says, the rocks cry out that you are God. Father, I am so grateful that you have made forgiveness and life eternal with you possible. Adoption as a child of the King possible. And I praise you, Father, for being a God who is gracious and is merciful, but is also just. And so, Father, I pray that you would help us to see that the two things, mercy and grace and justice, are not exclusive of each other, but that, Father, you are the one true God, and that we can come to you and trust you no matter what's going on around us. You are with us, and we don't have to be afraid. Thank you, Father, for that.
Father, we also want to pray for fellow believers as individuals. God, there are many different representations in this room, whether it's business owners, teachers, stay-at-home parents, or whatever it might be, Lord. And every person has their own challenges and their own fears and struggles. And Lord, just in light of what we have coming up this week, but also just what that implies for the rest of the next year, Lord, we ask, one, that you help them remember where their hope is found. God, whatever it is, that wherever it is you've placed us, that you help us turn to you first. before we turn to other things that might promise comfort but in reality can't fulfill that. God, help them see how they can represent you in this world, how they can shine your light no matter what the results are this next week. God, because we are yours first, and let that be our hope as we seek to live out the lives that you have given us.
Father, we also pray for our church and churches across our nation as they continue to seek to put you first. Father, as they join together as one so that the world might be one, and that as a church we might be a light that is reflecting into the community, that among the people we live, and not something that's put in a bush, a covering over the light, but that the light shines bright because they see your love, they see your light, they see your mercy, they see your justice shining forth. God, we pray for our church and every church, not just in this country, but around the world, that we might be the light of the world, as your son challenged us to be all those years ago as he walked the face of the earth, helping us understand how we can be the children of God and continue your mission to bring light and life, eternal life, to a world that was lost in darkness.
Lord, we want to take time to pray for our nation as well. It's been mentioned already that there is this kind of post-Christian culture that we're in. Lord, but also on top of it, everyone has their own agenda, everyone has their own priorities, and when you combine them all together, it seems like everyone can be at each other's throats. And so, Lord, we just pray, one, that we as your church as a whole can shine your light so that this nation can see you. As things can be kind of tumultuous and as things can be just shaken up in a lot of ways, as there is a lot of that anger and fear that kind of defines our nation today, it seems like, Lord, let the peace that makes no sense, that can only come through Jesus, shine brightly so that this nation can turn to you, Lord.
Father, we pray for whoever is elected president the coming week or weeks or however long it might drag out, Lord, of past experience, we don't know. But God, we pray that that person will be used by you for your glory and your purposes, whether they want to or not. God, we pray for blessings in their life. We pray for protection and provision because you've promised that nobody's in that position or power in any nation of the world that you're not aware of and haven't designed that. Father, we don't always understand why, but we don't question you. We trust you. We love you. And so, Father, we pray that whether it is Donald Trump or Kamala Harris, that you would go before them, behind them, beside them, above them, below them, and use them for your purposes and for your glory, even when we don't understand it. God, use them, even if they don't want to be used. Use them and be glorified, Father, we pray.
Father, we also just want to pray for those who are excited and those who are discouraged by whoever it is that becomes president, Lord. We've unfortunately seen poor reactions in the past. We've seen bad behavior in the past. We've seen that disrespect and that anger really shine through. And Lord, we just ask that there can be a spirit of gentleness. Lord, that even if it's not what I'd hoped for, Lord, that we can, again, for those who are believers, remember that my hope is not ultimately in who is president. My hope is in you. But Lord, on top of that, even for those who don't know you, that they can trust that things will move forward. It's not the end of the world and we don't have to act like it. Lord, we just pray for good reactions, that this nation doesn't tear itself apart just based off of who's in the Oval Office, Lord. God, we ask these things all in your powerful name.
Your holy name. We pray in Jesus' name. I would like us to close together by praying together. the prayer that Jesus taught us to pray. So if you'd stand and join with us, and we would like to close our time together by all of us together praying the Lord's Prayer. Our Father in heaven, ever. And all God's people said,
amen.
Amen. We have an amazing God, and we have an amazing country. Let's go forth and let that light be seen. God bless you. Thank you for putting up with our rambling, and have an amazing week. We look forward to seeing you next week.
Song again, whatever.